I didn't really do much encouraging with my friends from DeVries because a few months ago they presented to me a piece of research that they had done into the sort of content marketing phenomenon and raising the question of whether we had reached peak marketing or at least whether we were generating peak content, and whether we were generating content that nobody was paying attention to anymore. And that has evolved from there into a conversation about what they call brand ambiguity. I am well known throughout the industry for having a loathing for made-up words, but I think this one actually makes sense in terms of describing a real phenomenon. And they are going to build on that now with a fascinating discussion about culture wars. It's a conversation that will be led by Loretta Markevics, and she's going to come up to the stage, introduce everybody else, and lead you through 45 minutes of fun. Thank you very much.
Yes, you can clap. It's okay. Okay. So thank you, ladies, for joining us today. Today we have Lisa Lutoff-Perlo to my left, who is president and CEO of Celebrity Cruises, and the only woman CEO of a multi-million dollar publicly traded cruise line.
Billion. Let's get that.
Sorry.
Let's get that.
Billion. Lisa is a leader, a course, an innovator, a smart disruptor who challenges assumptions about the cruise industry and a lot of other things as well. Lisa is a champion of women in leadership and diversity of all kinds, actually, and has raised the bar for that in her industry. Thalia Mavros, welcome, is the architect of the rapidly ascending digital platform, The Front, a new media proposition showcasing the female voice in documentary film and entertainment around the world. She was, she is a creative director, filmmaker, and until recently was executive creative director at Vice Media. Thalia spent her career breaking conventions, just like Lisa, and now with The Front, she's expanding the dialogue to highlight a variety of work by leading women creatives everywhere. The Front's message is by women, for the world. And then we have Heidi Hovland, who is a PR veteran and CEO of DeVries Global, a global boutique agency within the Interpublic Group. So welcome, ladies.
Thanks for joining us today.
We're talking culture today, leading culture, not chasing it. And so the inspiration for this panel came from a recent study, as Paul said, DeVries Global conducted that tested a hypothesis, which is, are brands losing differentiation and impact as a result of trying to hop on trending topics in culture as a means to connect with consumers versus becoming a trending topic all their own? So Heidi, can you kick us off with some context?
Absolutely. So, there we are.
Oh.
Okay, so again, we identified a phenomenon in the marketing world and really identified it as a crisis for brands in distinction and standing out. And we did give it a catchy name. Thank you, Paul, for approving. And we do think it's a result of our self-created need to create content 24/7. So we had the hypothesis, we did some research to prove it, and we found that consumers are noticing. So 54% of consumers feel that brands are creating content for content's sake. And an even higher percent of the influencer segment believe that brands are jumping on any trending cultural topic, whether or not it's relevant to their brand. And it's not just annoying. It's a business problem as well. Fully a third of consumers said they've stopped buying a brand because of how it communicates. So we think there are a couple reasons for brand ambiguity. One is that volume is still a success metric, and many brands feel that more is more, more is better. We also think that there is this rising sense of FOMO. So brands worry that if they don't jump into a cultural conversation, their competitor will, and somehow a golden brand building moment will have escaped them forever. And again, these are not always cultural moments that have anything to do with the business they're in or the brand, the values they uphold. So that's why you have an upscale jewelry brand celebrating National Hot Dog Day. It's why you have a party hard tequila brand wishing mothers everywhere a happy Mother's Day. And sadly, it's why the passing of a beloved celebrity has become a brand opportunity. So when we really started digging, it became abundantly clear that this phenomenon lives across categories. And while it's most prevalent in social, it lives across the marketing mix. So, you know, we looked at fashion, we looked at spirits, high-end, low-end, we looked at beauty, we looked at travel, and even healthcare. It's a really interesting exercise, actually, if you check it out yourself. So the loss of brand distinction, the antidote to brand ambiguity, we believe, is identifying what your brand stands for in culture and making that your key pillar and your key filter.
Yeah, we've heard a lot about, you know, purpose today, but really not just having a purpose, but really drilling home how you connect to that purpose. So Lisa, what's your reaction to that?
Well, it's all very interesting. And as I look at all of the things through the screen as they were going through, and as Heidi was speaking, I think they're all extremely relevant, not only to celebrity cruises, but primarily and most importantly to our industry. There is a lot of brand ambiguity in our industry because people don't understand it well enough. Not enough of the population has taken a cruise, so there's some confusion in education that we have to do anyway. And when people think about a cruise, they just think about either stereotypes that are pretty negative, or just when they see a cruise or a cruise ad, they see the same visuals, they see the same big white boats, ships, and they just don't know how to differentiate them, and they don't know why celebrity is different. And when you spend your time creating an experience that is that are these beautiful boutique hotels sailing around the world delivering this amazing experience, you come to a very quick realization, at least I did, excuse me, when I started this job a couple of years ago, that you have to break out, you have to break away. And it can't be about the fact that you just cruise around the world and offer great things on board, because everybody else will tell people the same thing, and people will one-up you. And as we looked about culture and thought about our own brand and our own purpose, we thought about, you know what, we need to lead the conversation a little differently. We need to change the conversation. People buy brands that share their values. Their values have to align with what they do, because those examples are terrible. And so when you think about that and you take a step back, you have to say, what business am I in? What do we care about? What values do we live every day? And then how do we lead a cultural conversation about cruising, and more specifically about celebrity? And that's when we came to our brand purpose, and it was an offshoot of our culture. And when we realized what we valued and thought about every day and how we lived what we do and the team and our crew on board our ships, we realized that we might be onto something. And so that's the journey we have now embarked upon, and one that's really exciting for us because we see it's working, and we see that we are leading conversation.
That's great.
In a different way.
And then Thalia, you know, you spoke about the connection between what you are internally and externally. And I think it's, you know, Lisa, we definitely, you have a new campaign out there. We're going
to
show that.
Yeah, we'll get to
for
that.
For sure. But I think you agree.
Absolutely. I'm coming from a documentary filmmaking perspective and a background, I've seen the world and the world of creative change a lot, in the sense that people value more about, and brands are valuing more about co-creating stories and going in and asking, what are you most proud of? What is it that you most think about? And not simply, oh, this is something that's trendy right now, we want to jump on that, the purpose or the cause, but actually something that there's a through line from your internal values all the way out into the external, into the external culture. So internal culture to external, that we find those stories and we tell those together, right? Now, on the other side of that, I've been getting how many briefs lately, I mean, in the last few years, everybody wants like, oh, can you create an anthemic piece for me where it's like I speak to women or girls, or it speaks about how girls are having a hard time in the world, or how can we own that? But can it be authentic? And it's like, okay, let's have a conversation. So I always go back to the brands and the agencies and I ask them, okay, where is this coming from? What are the things that you're talking about? What's your history? How did you come to this place in the world, and why are you championing this message? So I always try and challenge and step back and go, okay, how are we ending up here, and do I believe it? I'm very jaded as a human being, so for me...
You're not alone.
And I often think to myself, I'm very jaded, but I also want to believe. Mm-hmm. I just want to believe. Okay. So in that sense, I think the audiences are the same way.
Right.
We all look at it and go, okay, why are you credible to talk to me about this? Why are you telling me this story? But the minute I believe it, and the minute that you can look me, and the brand can look me in the eyes and have that humanity, mm-hmm. we fall in love, mm-hmm. right? So, and our job on this side is to tell those stories that help them fall in love. And I think my earpiece is falling off here. Okay.
I think, Lisa, you know, I do want to show the campaign mm-hmm. that Celebrity just yeah. launched, because it's a great example of a brand that has a belief system that's connected to what you do.
Yes, very much
it's
so.
It's not just for the sake
very
of
much
doing
so.
It. Do you guys mind rolling that
can
video?
Can I just set
oh,
it up
set
a little
up?
Bit?
Sure.
Do you
yeah.
mind just for a second? Because what's really important is what you just said. You have to find a connection that makes sense. And the other thing is I think you need a cultural moment. Mm-hmm. And if you let the cultural moment pass, you don't get on the bus because you're a little late. And I think it's what you're talking about right now, Thalia, right? Where companies are saying, okay, how do I do this anthemic piece about, you know, young women yeah. and girls? Well, Dove and Always have already done that, and they did it brilliantly, and to do it again is just kind of a me too. So I was very fortunate to work with our agency partner, DeVries, and Weber to talk about our purpose and my own purpose. And then I was also very fortunate to bring someone into our brand who has a very different background, combined with a new agency. And we took a look and said, what is it that we need to worry about as an industry right now, and how do we break away? And there's two things. Number one, I told you about how people think about cruising in the big white boats, and we wanted to think about them. We wanted people to think about cruising and brands differently. We absolutely know and believe, and there's a ton of evidence to show, that people buy brands that share their values, and there are people who won't buy brands because they don't share their values. So we also had to make a conscious decision that if people didn't share our values, they probably weren't sailing with us anyway, and we had to be okay with the fact that they might never sail with us ever. And so in order to stand for something, you have to be against something, and you have to be okay with that. And then what we also saw was, because of what was going on around us, the conversation, the climate, we saw Americans hunkering down. We saw them not wanting to travel as much as they used to. We saw them not wanting to go where they used to go. So if you take our values and our core belief and our culture and put that aside for a minute, and you think about my job and what I need to do in my job, it was hurting us. It was hurting our business. And we said, enough. We can't just stand back and listen to this anymore. People, Americans, have to travel, and they have to embrace other cultures, and they have to be open to the world. And so we put together a campaign. It's called Sail Beyond Borders, and now we would like to share that spot with you.
He's ready. Yeah, it's beautiful work, really beautiful. So it takes a certain kind of personality to step up and say we have to stand for something more than just what our, you know, function of our brand is and what we know the barriers to conversion are. right? And so when you think about how you were feeling, right, during that time and what it takes to actually lead culture, right? What were you thinking when you first launched this? What did it take you to get there?
So here's what I thought, because anytime you do something like that, it is a risk, but it needs to be a calculated risk, and you have to believe that the majority of people agree with you, regardless of what their other beliefs are. They have, you know, I believe that as Americans first, we believe that we believe in certain things, and so as we were thinking about doing that, we weren't sure what the reaction would be. But I have to tell you, there were a percentage, but as we anticipated, a very small percentage of people who hated it, hated us, hated me. That's never easy. It was easier for me to put that aside when I read the overwhelming and saw the overwhelmingly positive response to that message. Mm. You know, it was meant to be an anthemic piece about our core philosophy as a brand in the travel business sailing to 7 continents and opening the world up to people who choose to cruise with us. And it was also a validation of the fact that we have crew on board our ships that come from over 50 countries around the world. And history would suggest they shouldn't get along with each other, but they walk on those ships as strangers, they quickly become family, and they unite for each other and our guests in a really powerful and meaningful way, and I think the world could learn a lot from the crew on cruise ships. So our feeling was we had a firm belief the majority of people would agree with us. And so the feedback that I have gotten has been amazing. And it went on national news, and it wasn't just celebrity. Interestingly enough, there were quite a few brands that took advantage of this cultural moment. We aired that right after the first presidential debate. So we weren't alone in our thinking. We took a very different approach. But anyway, social media went crazy. Hundreds of millions of impressions, the vast majority neutral and positive, and in social media, that's a good thing. So we made a statement. It worked beautifully. It changed the conversation, and now it's our opportunity just to continue to build on that and build on that message and that culture.
That's great. And Thalia, so you say you get briefs like this all the time. Yeah. You know, how do you prepare your clients? Like, what does it take to lead culture?
We often see, and we talk about brands being on a spectrum, and there are the leaders and creators of culture, which is a small minority, and they're really at the bleeding edge, and it takes a lot of courage, and they can get a lot of flack for it, but they stand for what they believe in. They're with the emerging trends, and they're leading kind of the conversation, which is a hard thing to do, and it takes a lot of courage and a lot of curiosity, right? Cultural curiosity. Then we have most brands, and they're kind of following culture and going along with it, and it's easy to jump on trends, but people can do a good job of navigating and trying to find, like we talked about, that through line, and that's mostly mainstream culture, and you had a few that kind of missed the boat completely, really. Yeah. And
no pun intended.
Yeah. Missed the ship completely.
Very good.
And we see the brands, we know a lot of the brands that we're talking about that are at that head. And what I like to say and what I like to see a lot is when you're leading culture, brands can't be expected to lead culture by themselves, right? And it's about collaboration and finding co-creators of culture, finding creatives, people who create and amplify their vision, people who help distribute, people who help tell their stories through their personal lens, right? What is culture? It's the lens that brands tell these stories through, that our shared values, what we're believing in, what we're talking about. So We were talking about curiosity, courage, collaboration. I think that's very important. And the partners that that trip that you're going on, and I don't know why we're getting on all these metaphors of trips and journeys. I don't know. I'm a very visual person, so I'm like, oh.
It has that effect on people.
Right. I like that.
I think that's a very important, something that I think about a lot, and selecting those partners. I mean, that's the world that I live in too, and how to become a great partner for people, right. And how to be able to really tell those stories, right. That in a meaningful way to all of us that are involved.
So, and as a brand, I would just like to completely 100% agree with Thalia, because you can't do that alone. When you're a brand and you have a certain way of thinking, you need amazing partners to work with that are going to help you, number one, take the risk, be brave, lead the conversation. I will tell you, no one in our category has followed us. I will tell you, I got private emails applauding it, but nobody has said, we're gonna talk about this too. On the one hand, that disappoints me. On the other hand, I'm like, good, because I don't want you jumping on this bandwagon, because we wanna own it and we deserve to own it because we believe it, and more importantly, we live it, and most importantly, we're not afraid to say it. And so, so I'm hoping they don't jump on the bandwagon of that culture. And I'm surprised we're the first. I don't even know how many in the travel industry, forget just the cruise industry, have been as forward in telling people to reject not wanting to experience the world and other people and cultures in a way that is meaningful, right. To get people, ignited again, to get back and go to great places.
So Heidi, you've seen, similar, this growth in popularity of wanting to make your mark on the world in a way that's connected to culture. So what do you think it takes from an agency perspective?
I think it takes a lot of guts. I think there's a reason nobody's followed in celebrities and Lisa's footsteps, because if you swim with the other fish, you're not going to get fired, you're not going to get in trouble, or at least that's how the old convention goes. And I think that's part of the reason for brambiguity. Social media is a huge stage upon which you can succeed or fail. So people are trying to succeed in a lot of tiny incremental ways, because standing up in a big way can be a fail. So I think the courage that it took for Lisa to do what she did, is pretty outstanding. And I think for an industry that has been fighting certain misperceptions, in some case, with some brands, maybe they're accurate perceptions. In celebrities' case, it's not. Is a result of people not having the courage to say something different, right. And to say something that is actually relevant to people who are not in that cruising set at all, who do not self-identify as anyone who would ever take a cruise. And so I really do think it's guts, and it's being willing to have people disagree with you, to maybe lose some customers along the way, but to gain maybe a deeper appreciation and a deeper loyalty from the ones who share your values. So
right.
there's integrity, and there's knowing who you are and what you stand for and not being afraid to say it.
And can I just say that it's also a direct line. A lot of brands that we're seeing don't have this direct line into this messaging, this purpose-driven messaging, right? And not to I didn't want to, there were a few cases that were brought up earlier, and a lot of respect to everybody's work, but there were a few brands that I kind of didn't understand, and I think a lot of people don't understand the connection, like Kenneth Cole and some of the purpose-driven messaging, which in my mind, I don't know, it's not a very straight line. Right. And I think there's something that when you talk about travel and crossing borders and the solution of borders that I understand, and it hits, there's a reason for existing as a company. And I feel like that's a really important thing. When we find the reason why a company exists and why I'm interacting with this company, and it's aspirational, and it elevates me and the company that together, this experience is elevated, then I think it just transforms the whole conversation and my relationship to the brand.
Yeah.
I think it's a big difference that...
It is a huge difference. And, some brands can try and fail, to Heidi's point, and then fail bigly.
Another made-up word.
Yes, I make up
words. You do.
So we are at time?
Out of time. If you want to take one, because we're kind of at the end of the day, and take one question from the audience, I'm going to uncharacteristically loosen up.
You're so generous.
Seriously, it's a very inspirational story and exemplifies a lot of what we talk about. So if there is a question from the audience, somebody is very aggressively chasing the mic.
Yep, this is for Lisa. I'm John Paul. I'm with M Booth. Full disclosure, I represent Carnival Cruise Line.
Okay.
But I sailed on Celebrity last year. Uh-huh. Amazing experience, so thank you. I would encourage everyone who hasn't cruised to do so. Two questions for
you.
What has the effect been on your business in terms of bookings? And second, follow-up to that, cruisers tend to be a little like risk-averse. Mm-hmm. And talk about the tension of getting people to like open their eyes and travel, but also the cruises pulling out of Turkey and not giving that experience.
Yeah, so a couple things, it hasn't been that long since it ran. What we mostly watched outside, our bookings are very nice, thank you. Our call is our call is on Friday, so you can learn more if you wanna dial in. So I won't get too much into that. But what I looked at more than how many bookings we're getting was, did anyone cancel? And we saw no cancellation change in our business. And I happen to host a President's Cruise every year, so I was particularly interested if people were really mad at me, and so they were canceling sailing with me, and nobody canceled. So 2,000 people that are sailing with me next May are still sailing with me next May. So I used those as two indicators that we didn't lose a lot of business from it. But there's not a... You know, people don't see something and book immediately. You know that well. You're in this business, and many of us who represent brands know there's some period of time. But, you know, first of all, to Heidi's point, I got so many people who said to me, this is why I love Celebrity, and this is why I will always stay with Celebrity. So it did a lot, I think, to cement the loyalty with people that are like-minded and that share our values. And I got I can't even tell you how many people who said, I haven't cruised, Celebrity has made me want to cruise, and when I do, it will be with your brand, which was exactly the purpose of the spot. And I do think there's a balance of taking people to experience the world and making sure you don't take them to places that the world knows are very dangerous and disproportionately dangerous. And so what is also very sad for me, as I've been in this business now for almost 32 years, is I see the places in the world that have been the most beautiful and the most wonderful to visit. You know, many people just won't go there anymore, whether you're a cruise line or you're a hotel. You know, you look at Egypt, you look at Israel, the Holy Land cruises, Turkey. These are beautiful, wonderful places that it is my strong hope will resurface as the amazing destinations where people can go and all be safe and happy and have a wonderful time. So yeah, there is always that, and that's not unlike any other group in the travel business. And you know, the thing about cruising is that it's our job. You know, for 32 years, I started out selling as a DSM in Massachusetts. I'm still telling people the same thing 32 years later. I'm like, what the heck? come on, people. So it's a journey, you know, one day at a time, one step at a time. But I think this is a meaningful step to start changing that conversation.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thank you so much.